It's time for the summer of vlogging with Luke and Juliana. I'm Luke, I'm in front of the camera for this one. Juliana is behind the camera. Say hi, Juliana.
Hello.
And summer of vlogging is going to be weekly vlogs starting now, running for 8 weeks until the European Juggling Convention, and then we will be switching to daily vlogs. Oh, that's the plan. Right, so today, the vlog update, we're going to be talking about a trick. This trick here. By Anthony Gatto, but also by me. I've been learning this trick, and I did a whole vlog update about learning it and building the props and stuff and finding the right rings, and this is the update. Since then, I chatted with some other jugglers online chats with people, including Cody Harrington, who actually performs a version of this in his show. He doesn't catch the ring on the ball at the end, but you know, he has a similar looking prop. I also bought some new rings. I mentioned in the last update that I was, of course, then I was just using these different multicolored rings. And then I went to the British Juggling Convention and I did the trick a few times. Then other people tried out the juggling prop. Luca Ferdomenges took a very, very long time to catch the ball on top of the ring on top of the ball at the end, which is quite funny. And also at the British Juggling Convention, I bought a new ball, a new spinning ball. Well, this was the previous ball, and this is just one that I already have in my case. And that was a really handy thing because, hey, I already have this. I'll, you know, inflate the ball to the right size so the ring catches on top, and that can be it. Unfortunately, these Pilates balls that you get from Decathlon are quite old, and it's a bit nasty. So I was looking for a new one and I found one. And I found that it's really difficult to get these balls though that are actually good because they're all like different sizes and thicknesses. I think they just like randomly make them. I don't even know how it does because like every time that you inflate one to the same pressure, literally it can be this big or it can be this big, just depending maybe on how much rubber that they put in the mold. I'm not sure how it works out. So I got myself a new ball which spins not quite as well, but I think looks a lot better. What do you think, Juliana?
Looks nice.
It does look nice.
And it's sparkly.
Yeah, and it's got this kind of sparkle sheen to it. This is like a dead orange. This is nice and sparkly. The advantage is that it packs flat. The disadvantage is that it doesn't look fantastic. And we, and the last one, we're talking about the solid, clear plastic ball that Anthony Gatto uses in his show. Like this, when the light is shining on it, it's so great. And I think I mentioned before that I was like, hey, it's probably a hamster ball. Spoilers for maybe this is in the title of this video. Hamster ball is Anthony Gatto's favorite prop, and we discovered, of course, by doing the research, that it's this one. It's called a Savic Mini Animal Game Runner 25 centimeter assorted colors, and as you can see, there's different colors. This is like a clear one, kind of. They also have like this one, which is more of a bluish color. Anthony Gatto has used various different colors as well. The most obvious one is this one. Can you see that there? Bright orange, like that. This is actually the earliest video that I can find of Anthony Gatto using a hamster ball. And it's really, really clear that he's using a hamster ball. Because if we just rewind the video a bit and look at it, as he's throwing the ball up, actually the lid comes off in his hand, you see? You see this here?
Yeah.
And the lid comes off in his hand, and then he throws it up, and he's still got the lid in his hand. Yeah. And when it catches there, he passes the lid across to his assistant, and you throw the, and you can actually then see there's this hole, like there's a hole in the ball. Anthony Gatto juggles with a hamster ball. So I wasn't quite sure about buying one, but because they were out of stock. They were out of stock on Amazon. But then, beginning of this month, they came in stock, and Juliana was like, buy it, and I was like, I will buy it, but there was no way to choose the color, so I was hoping for a clear plastic ball, but actually what arrived is, I wouldn't say deep blue, but kind of like rich blue. What color would you call this, Juliana?
Yeah, I would call it blue turquoise.
Blue turquoise. So yeah, I got this ball, and I decided to try it out. And the first thing that I did, of course, was pick up a ring, and I was like, these are the rings that I normally perform with, not the new rings from play, but these are the old beard rings that I do. And I was like, great, so you can throw it up, and oh no.
Oh.
this is a 25 centimeters, and you're like, oh yeah, that's 25 centimeters. But the tolerances are like really close, you see that?
Yeah.
So, but that wasn't the rings that I've been training with, so hear about the play rings. What about this? When you drop this on top, you're like, oh, that's really great, except.
It seems to stick.
But it's kind of dependent on the angle of the ball. Like, you put the ball one way around and drop it on, oh, it sticks. But if you put the ball this way on, it falls down. Now, that is not good for, you know, performing or training.
Too random.
Yeah, it's totally random. You jump on, great, here, here, not so great. Mm. So I was thinking, we need to, like, this is a conversation with me and you, and I was like, maybe I need to put some on top of it, maybe some tape to make it a bit bigger. And then I was like, but we can poke things through when we were experimenting. Because then I was like, maybe I need to, like, make some new rings, which were exactly, you know, exactly the same. Yulian was like, why don't you just modify the rings? I was like, that is it.
Yeah.
So I modified the ring. It's quite a simple modification. It's just sort of like some tape around the inside, but not like pushed down really flat. You can maybe not see it, but that made it so every time you throw it on there, it comes over and bonk, like that. About it, like bonk, and it doesn't fall through. Like, it hasn't fallen through yet since I put that tape on there.
It's very satisfying.
It is very satisfying when that happens. The thing that I was worried about, though, was this, the way that this, I'd made this thing, was that these edges were just sort of like the bare aluminium, like pokey bits. Because this is like hard plastic, so that's why I put these rubber tips on there, which I don't really like the look of that much, but I needed some protection for the ball to go on top. And then I went off to train at the catapult. I was very nervous about this ball because it's made out of solid plastic. Anthony Gatto can get away with using something which is quite delicate because Anthony Gatto doesn't drop on stage. I mean, maybe he does, but you don't see him mess up on stage that much. Whereas I will mess up on stage. And with these rubber balls, no problem at all. Like, I can mess up this as much as I want, on stage, off stage, practicing, warming up. Don't need to worry about it at all. But this I was nervous about. So my first thing that I did was that I put down a mat and I went and stood on the mat and I was like, all right, if anything goes wrong. And I was balancing it and I was like, I'm not really sure about this. And so I actually did some tests, first of all, with the blue ball, just to see, let's just get used to throwing the ball up there so I'm not immediately doing it with this. And I tried doing some tests of like what would happen if I throw this up and try and make it bounce off of the balance pole quite a bit. And I was like, this is working out. And so then I did this for the first time. And tell you something, this is scary. Because you throw it up, it doesn't feel that much heavier. In fact, actually, it does feel a lot heavier. Put your hand out, Juliana. Okay, this is the heavy one, yeah? And then this is the light one.
Yeah.
And another thing about the heaviness, which was weird, is that I picked it up and I reached down to pick it up with one hand. And normally with the rubber ball, I just grab it and it picks up. And here I was like, I can't just like grab it with one hand. And then I threw it. And the first time, I think it went in. The second time, it didn't go in. And it kind of fell down. I was like, whoa, like this, and had to catch it. And I was having to be like way more like, I was way more nervous about catching this ball than the rubber ball, which I could just let bounce on the floor.
Yeah, and also because you still have the pole on your chin, also need to deal with that falling.
I had to kind of always abandon that. Like, the most important thing to catch, normally the most important thing to catch was this, because I don't want it like falling or bouncing or anything. But now this is the most important thing to catch. So I tried it a few times, and it was actually very satisfying because it would go up and come down and just be thunk. You know, it actually bounces a little bit less, you know, and that's the thing, when I throw this and catch it on there, like, it doesn't bounce. And I realized that the times with the rubber ball that I would bail out of the trick and immediately grab this and try and catch it, it was then just working with this, because when it came down and it would hit here, the weight of it would just kind of force itself down into place, and it would do this, you know, it would come in down and do this thunk kind of thing, which doesn't do, and it's kind of noisy as well. So that was another thing that I discovered. Then I started, actually doing some juggling. Because I only had one ring which had been modified, I was having to keep track of the other rings. I'd have three color-changing rings and then the one ring. And I was really struggling with the trick. And it turns out it was a massive amount of, of processing overhead in my brain, just keeping track of this ring. So I'd start juggling and I'd be like, not that ring, not that thing. Okay, catch that one on the thing. Not that ring, not that ring thing. And then at one point I'd be like, oh no. And then I'd like swap them between my hands to make sure that I had the right one. And then when I did it with five rings and I was juggling five and making sure that I didn't throw that one at the start. And then once I'd thrown the first one, carry on, and then which one's good. And I was like looking at the rings. If you're looking for which one isn't red, it's like this negative, it's this not, you know, like the logic operator is the other way around. It's not like, oh yeah, if I see red, that's the right one. It's like, if I don't see red, that's the right one. But a lot of the time that you're juggling rings, you don't see the red because it's on this side. So So I was really, really struggling with the trick. This was just dropping into place perfectly, like clunk onto place. And when I threw this ring and caught it, it was great. But it was actually the juggling in between which was breaking my brain trying to keep track of the one ring that I was going to throw. So I did the inevitable. I took the white tape that I'd used for that with me to the catapult, and I modified four other rings. So now all of these have got tape on them. So I could then just juggle, and as soon as that happened, it was like, and there's a version of the trick where I juggle five and I throw and catch the first ring, like on the hook, but then I stop juggling and then I juggle four and then do the rest of the trick. So that pause of juggling, to be honest, probably how I'm going to perform it for the first time, because the, you know, juggling five and transitioning to catching one and into four with no stopping is quite tricky. So, and then I just kind of just got it twice in a row and I was like, oh, that's really handy just to be able to do, I can just do the trick again. It's because I haven't been training it very much, you know, because I've been traveling and not doing as much training. So yeah, it was really interesting. And I got the full trick a few times, and just the throwing the ring up and catching on it is a real, it's like a breakthrough. You know, I had like a training breakthrough. However, it's not all good. And I'm going to run through the good and the bad. Shall we do it?
Let's do it. Which one you start with, good or bad?
Well, good or bad, or which ball? Which one are we going to start? Okay, let's start with the good. Good, you know, it packs down really flat. Don't need to worry about it. It's not fragile. It's everything about this ball is like comfortable, easy. I can pick it up with one hand. Don't have to worry about it at all. You see, so that's good about that. What's bad about it is that it doesn't look fantastic. And also, if I never need a replacement, I've got to like, I actually bought five of these blue rubber balls, and only two of them are actually fitted together well enough to use. You know, it's impossible to find a good replacement with these. Like, okay. I cleared out the decathlon in Ramsgate to make one ball, which is good. I would still use this for spinning balls probably, but maybe that's about it. This looks fantastic. So looks wise, but then this is more difficult. Like when I travel with this, like I take it apart and like pack these down and maybe put stuff inside of it. Like this does come in half, but it doesn't, I don't know, it doesn't feel good. And then it's like really delicate. I actually did that entire training session and only dropped it once in the entire training session, which I was very proud of.
Well done.
Yeah, but that is a lot of stress to train with this.
Any damage?
Well, yeah, I don't know if it came from the dropping, but yeah, there is damage. And this is the other thing. This cost like 17 euros or whatever it was, and it's already cracked. Can we see, is that a crack? No, that's a scratch. That's a scratch. Here's, look at this. Can you see this? I'm not sure if you can. Yeah. Can you see that? Yeah. Like, it's already cracked. I don't know if that's like really structural. So what do I do with this? Bad about this, it's already cracked after one training session. If I perform with it, do I just have to take two of them? Do I have to take like spares? Like if I buy another one, will it also be blue? I don't know. Like who knows about it? So yeah, there is good math. The other thing, it is heavy. When it lands, it goes thunk. It actually makes a sound. Like the rubber one, no sound at all. It's like, ah, sound. And this one makes a big thunk, which is kind of unnerving, really. Yeah, and also if I miss it and it comes down, I catch it. Listen to that.
Oh.
As it comes down. This is the sound it makes. Like, of course I can go, like, try and catch it nicely, but then I'm just trying to grab it out of the air. It's like really, it's a clunk. So there's good and bad in both things. I think for training, it makes sense to train a lot with the rubber ball just because it's less stressful. For performing, though, it might be good to work with this because actually, it's like training for a marathon. You know when they put weights on their legs or whatever, and you run a lot, and then you train without the weights on your legs, and suddenly it's like, oh, it's really easy. This is actually easier. Like, when you're catching it, it takes less precision. Like, it falls into place better, and the ring kind of just goes slot on top. It's really nice. It feels good. But to train with it, it doesn't feel good.
And it also looks amazing.
It does look amazing.
It makes some fun visual effects with it.
Yeah, like and also like I can spin it on my finger, and you know, that looks amazing. I don't know if that's gonna go in the show. Like I can't use this as like in the run finish, you know. But if I want to present the ball in some way to show that, oh, it's actually an empty ball, it's great. Yeah, we can do the light shining through it. We were talking about having like a flashlight or a torch, which is remote control, which could be mounted here at the back. And when this lands on top, it can shine up through. Oh, another thing that I mentioned as well, actually, the wire that I use as this ring, can you see how bent down it is?
Yeah.
It's because when this hits it, it just bends it.
Okay.
The rubber ball bounces off that thing.
Yes.
And this hits it and just bends it like this. But yeah, when I was talking to people at the catapult, they're like, oh, from a distance, you don't see it's a hamster ball.
No,
of course, when you go like this, you're like, oh, hamster ball. But from back here, not a hamster ball, just a cool, cool looking ball. So yeah, I think on balance, I'm gonna definitely use this, train with it a bit, but I think mostly I'm gonna stick with the other ball just because it's easier to travel with. Like, I'm going to the European Juggling Convention, and I want to take this balance pole to train with there. I'm not taking this to the European Juggling Convention. Just imagine this in the gym, like dropping it and it rolls somewhere and someone will pick it up and go, here it is, and they'll throw it back to me and I'll be like, no, and like that. So yeah, it just feels good. Like, it feels, when it works perfectly and it just goes thunk, oh, it feels perfect. You know, when the ring goes thunk, oh, it's so good. But to get there, to train to get there is gonna be a little bit scary, I think.
Yeah. It will be the one thing that you will only take out your case for the one performance.
Yeah, for the show.
1 second.
But here's the thing. Let's talk about it. Shall I just buy some more? Like, buy one or two more just so I have some spares? Maybe get a assorted colors. Maybe I'll get an orange one like Anthony Gatto's first one that you did.
I would say yes.
Clear one. Yeah.
I would say yes.
Yeah, so I might get some more of those. That's it for this vlog. A bit of an update. That it's going quite well. I'm enjoying juggling it again. I mean, I always was enjoying juggling, but it's been fun to like make another step in getting this trick ready to perform. So here's the thing about weekly vlogging. The way it works is this: one vlog per week. I'd like to thank my Patreon supporters for like making this kind of thing possible. But here's the thing: a few years ago at the European Juggling Convention, we got some more patrons because we were doing daily vlogs. And I'm like, this is a good thing. And what I'm looking for is, at the moment, we have 55 Patreon supporters, which is good. That's really nice. It's a great motivation. I really enjoy the support. But I think we get to 100. What do you think, Juliana? 100 Patreon supporters in
for
8 weeks?
Daily vlogs?
Yeah. Here's the thing. It's up to you, people watching this video. If you want daily vlogs from the EJC, which I enjoy doing, and Juliana enjoys doing, and is good fun, but it takes a lot of work. It's like 4 hours a day at the EJC, every day, to do daily vlogs. That's about how much time and effort we put in. So if you want that, go to patreon.com/LukeBurridge, sign up to support Juliana, and buy, even if you just give $1, €1, £1, whatever the amount is for the donation. That's all we're looking for, a signal of support. We're looking for 100 Patreon supporters in time for the EJC, and then we will definitely commit to doing daily vlogs from the EJC. And if we don't get to 100, it's a lot more up in the air, and maybe we'll just take it as a bit more of a vacation, and I'll just spend time organizing fight night combat, and that'll be my only responsibility. So what do you think, Juliana? Is that good?
That's a good plan.
All right, well, thank you to our current supporters, and we'll give an update in the next weekly vlog, which will be coming out next week, if we had any progress on the Patreon supporters. So thanks for watching this, and we'll catch you next time.
Goodbye.